Roberts & Roberts Brokerage presents Keenevention 2015's Political Action Panel. Roberts & Roberts, when you're serious about precious metals. Online at rrbi.co.
So welcome to Keenevention 2015. It's the third annual Keenevention. And this year we're doing things a little bit differently. Now there's still all of the panels and the keynote speeches, but this year for the first time there will be a real live auction happening. One of the auction prizes will benefit the Free Ross Defense Fund, and that will be matched, the winning bid, up to $1,000 by Bitcoin.com. So stick around. That live auction will happen after the Bitcoin panel, before the secession panel this afternoon on Friday. And we still are going to have the regular raffle. I am still getting set up in the back, but after this panel, tickets will go on sale. One ticket for $1, six tickets for $5, 13 tickets for $10, your height in tickets for $25. There's a lot of good prizes, including a mystery box and a stay at Stone Farm Bed and Breakfast. There's also books. There are pins from shinybadges.com. There's all kinds of great prizes. They're all going to be set up on the table there in the back. So the more tickets you buy, the more chances you have to win. And buying a ticket makes you eligible for everything because it all goes into one pool there. So this is the first ever political action panel. And in years past, we've had the legislative panel, and I believe that panel is coming back, but most of the time they focus on ways to be successful as Republicans and Democrats. And well, people can be successful in politics outside of the two-party system. And I first want to introduce my panelist. I, of course, am Darryl W. Perry. I'm libertarian activist. I'm currently the vice chair of the New Hampshire Libertarian Party, one of the co-founders of the New Hampshire Liberty Party, which is a pro-secession political party here in New Hampshire. First guest is Chris Rietmann. He is currently a selectman in Alstead, or is it Alstead? I always get it confused if it's Alstead or Alstead.
Alstead.
Alstead. And Chris was the man behind, as far as on the select board, the man behind repealing all of the gun restrictions in the town of Alstead. That there's not really record that any of them were passed, but they were being enforced as if they had been passed. Chris also attempted a sheriff's run here in Cheshire County. And maybe we'll talk about that a little bit later. To his left is Don Gorman. Don is one of four people, I believe it's four, that served in the New Hampshire legislature, elected as members of the Libertarian Party, running as libertarians. And Don was the leader of the Libertarian Caucus of the New Hampshire legislature for two terms back in the 90s. And then to his left is John Babiarz, multi-time Libertarian gubernatorial candidate, and also fire chief something up in Grafton.
That is correct. Fire chief in the town of Grafton.
So, again, the purpose of this is to talk about how people can be successful outside of the two-party system. And people define success differently. Some people define success outside the two-party system as winning an election. Other people define it in various ways. So first I want to start, and we'll start with Chris and then go down the line. How do you define being politically successful?
Well, I can understand how some would feel that getting elected is a good start, but it's not the only path. I think particularly in small towns in New Hampshire, elections aren't the only way that people end up in positions of responsibility in their communities. So, for example, sometimes people just make their positions. My town didn't have a budget committee, so I suggested we form a budget committee. they suggested that's a great idea. You lead it up. So sometimes you can do it that way. Sometimes vacancies occur and they will look to appoint people to fill that. That's how I became a selectman. And sometimes, you know, people just step down and those are openings that are there. I think if I were to define being successful, it's acquiring some position that you feel that you can help get your message across, that helps you get your message across, regardless of whether that's, you know, an elected position or appointed positions or sometimes just taking part in things.
Don?
Yeah, I want to mimic Chris's statements here. Absolutely concur. The name of the game here, really, when you're starting out, and I'm going to come from the point of view of elections or appointed service positions for a town. There's a lot of guys, for some reason, they wake up one morning and decide to run for president or something like that. You're not going to get elected as a libertarian from the presidency, so forget it. Let's go down to where you can get elected or appointed. Take something like most of these towns have a cemetery trustee type ship, and they're in charge of maintaining the grounds, organizing when there's a funeral, things of that nature. Generally, as three people on that committee, it's usually appointed by the selectman. How do you get on it? Basically, you go up and knock on the door because it's a kind of a position that is probably not filled. It probably has a vacancy or two on it. And all you have to do is indicate that you have an interest in serving in that position. Chances are probably 90% that you will get appointed to that position. Maybe not right that day, but maybe next March when one of the positions becomes vacant and some of the people that are on that committee at that time are stepping down. They no longer want to serve. Your name is at the top of the list and you get an appointment. Regardless of how you slice the cake, you are now serving in government at the town level. So that to me is where we begin here in New Hampshire.
John?
Well, I actually started out as a cemetery trustee. Basically, there was an opening, nobody signed up, and during the town meeting day, I asked a few people, had six write-in votes, and became a cemetery trustee. So basically, I started my political career 6 feet under and working my way up. One of the things to define political success doesn't always mean getting elected, but influencing policy. And I think over the course of time, because of exposure of a libertarian running for governor, I was able to make connections where I can influence policy leaders. One example is I ran against Craig Benson during the 2002 campaign, and later on he appointed me as his efficiency commission right-hand man. And that's a job that, believe it or not, I still perform to this day in various ways.
So, John, you really gave the answer that I was looking for, is success is defined as being able to influence policy. And that's something that a lot of people overlook when they look at what oftentimes are called third parties, but should rightly be called minor parties. And if you look back through history of American politics, you will see that political parties such as the Bull Moose Progressives from the early 1900s, the progressives from the 1920s, the socialists from the 1930s, they did not have what would be considered electoral success, but they did have success in that they were able to convince the Republicans and Democrats to basically co-opt their message and adopt a lot of their policies. And something that we're seeing now is, you know, the claim that a lot of Republicans are leaning libertarian in Congress, So, you know, would you consider, and this is a question for all of you, jump in however you like, would you consider that to be a quote-unquote success for libertarians? If so, why? If not, why not?
I would say yes and no. No, from a standpoint, we don't have our own political identity, but yes, in moving the policy. One of the things you have to remember is the Libertarian Party was formed in 72 because Richard Nixon violated core Republican principles. When that violation occurred, that made a lot of people angry, and they basically split off and figured out what is the ideal principle of liberty. And, you know, through committee and whatever, they came up with the original platform. But further off, both Democrat and Republican Party drifted off their core identity. In fact, they both engaged what I call crony capitalism. But now we're seeing the outcome of this 40 years later, and that is the Republican Party currently is in a three-way civil war: the Libertarian faction, the Establishment faction, and the Conservative faction. No matter how it comes out, I mean, I think the American people have had enough, but influencing policy, I think we've done pretty good as libertarians. One is the war on drugs. We've warned about the conclusions. We see where it's happening. Other states have decriminalized marijuana. We've been ahead of that curve. Homeschooling, we were well ahead of that curve. New money, we're ahead of that curve because you can't trust the government money anymore. Time and time again, the people that have the vision, and unfortunately that's my curse, I guess, is to be so far ahead of the curve that, will I see it in my lifetime? No, but at least I set the seeds. And I think that's the success. And as the policy changes towards a more freedom, we, the libertarians, are the ones that's pushing the envelope.
I'd like to weigh in on that, just to put a slightly more positive spin on it. While libertarians may not have always been successful at changing policy, what we are very successful at is changing the conversation. And that's something that we've seen in drug laws, we've seen in Fourth Amendment. You know, you look at what happened after Edward Snowden. We have lots and lots of examples of this happening. One example I wanted to give was, I had a very unsuccessful run for sheriff a couple years ago. Didn't even make it on the ballot, but it was interesting to get out and to talk to people and see what was on their mind. And not surprisingly to me, I did stir up a lot of interest in some far right wing groups because I was very, very pro Second Amendment. But it was interesting that from me talking about, you know, DUI stops and me talking about Second Amendment things and Fourth Amendment issues and the like, the other candidates started getting these questions too. And I thought that was kind of interesting that, you know, if you're a voice out there, then somebody hears it and somebody starts to scratch their head and say, well, I wonder what that guy thinks about that. That's where I think the real value of bringing ideas forward, even when they may seem impossible to pass as policy, we're still getting those in front of the people.
Yeah, I'd like to tell a little story. This actually happened. This is a real story. I was elected to the school board in Deerfield for four different terms as a libertarian. Now, it's a nonpartisan slot, technically, legally, but everybody in town knew I was a libertarian. I made no bones about it. I got elected four times to the school board, but in one of those events, we had a situation that is typical of influencing, say, the general population. We had a committee come before us that they wanted to buy some playground equipment for preschoolers. My first thought was, why a preschooler in the public school? But we'll skip over that one and go back to the equipment that needed to be bought. It was somewhere in the neighborhood of $30,000, and the presentation was, we have a grant. And I said, oh, so you're using taxpayers' money. No, we have a grant. I said, well, that's what I said. You're using taxpayers' money, so it's not free. You know, I said, these grants don't come from the money tree in Washington. Somebody's paying for that. That's us. Well, this and that and the other thing went back and forth. And I said, I can't approve of this. My vote is going to be no on this thing, which shocked the rest of the board. Also shocked the committee, but it shocked the rest of the board. I said, you're not bringing enough effort to bring the population of this town into this project. So here's my suggestion. If you want to present a proposal to us that's half the amount of the grant, in other words, 15,000 instead of 30, and then with the other 15,000, generate interest among the people in town to where they either donate, have a bake sale, come over and donate labor to put it together, or whatever, but get the population, our citizens, involved in this playground event. Bottom line was, everybody thought that was the greatest idea since sliced bread, and it went flying through, and that's exactly what happened, and half the town turned up to get involved in this this playground thing. And I sat back there and said to myself, quietly, if that isn't libertarian values at work, I don't know what the hell are. So yes, you can influence a great deal of thinking from any position that you're in.
So let's sort of shift gears just a little bit and talk about elections, because each one of you have been involved in at least one election. I've been involved in several. Don, let's start with you and your election to the State House in 1992, I believe it was. That's back when the Libertarians actually had ballot access in New Hampshire, so it wasn't as difficult to get on the ballot. You had to pay $2 instead of $2 and then go collect a bunch of signatures. So talk about your election a little bit. What sort of motivated you to run for state rep? Was that the first time you had ever run for political office?
No, I had been a state rep back in the early 70s. What specifically motivated me was, I don't want to brag, but it was political shrewdness, if you will. I saw an opportunity here, and I decided to fill it. The opportunity was that thanks to several people who spent hours collecting signatures in front of the Motor Vehicle Department and other places throughout the state, we had ballot access through signatures. So the opportunity was there. I knew I had the political savvy to be able to pull this off. I also knew that 99.9% of the population out there did not know a libertarian from a manhole cover. So the fact that the Libertarian Party was on the ballot was sort of like, okay, that's nice, I think. I took advantage of that ignorance. What I did is stepped into the gap as good old Don Gorman. Hi, how you doing? Hey, did you know I was running for the State House? Really? No kidding. We'd love to see you up there. Yeah, I'd love to be up there. Can I count on your vote? Never mentioned libertarian at all. I was looking for the votes. I was using their ignorance of the system to my advantage. It was shrewdness. It was deliberate. It was not an accident. And I was able to do this because the opportunity was there. I had the political experience from before, and I was a libertarian through and through. My motive was simple. Get elected and be in the State House, then you can influence other things. Don't try to fight the battle on the vote at the election day at the ballot box. Just be good old Don. Hey, I need your vote. Okay. Never a question of what party you're running under or anything else. So they went in, they looked for my name, they found it, gave me an X, and I got elected. Bingo.
Now, John, you have probably run more political campaigns than anybody on the stage, I'm guessing. How many times have you run for governor?
I ran four times.
Four times for governor, plus you've run for other offices?
Yes, I have. Local offices.
So talk about some of the gubernatorial campaigns, some of the problems that you've run into with collecting signatures and other various issues, because that, I want to talk about some of the downsides of being outside of the two-party system, you know, because obviously I wholeheartedly reject the idea of working with the Republicans or Democrats, because since their inception, they've worked to steal my freedom, so why should I try to work with them as far as inside their political party? Now, I'll form a coalition with somebody on a single issue, but I cannot in good conscience ever call myself a Republican or a Democrat. So I don't want to make it sound like it's all, you know, sunshines and rainbows and kitty cats working outside of the system. Yes, you are able to influence change every now and then, but it's definitely an uphill battle. So, John, talk about some of the struggles you had running for governor.
Well, again, the key thing is we libertarians have to start with the petitioning process. It's not an easy thing. An introvert is going to have a tough time at it. An extrovert probably will enjoy it. But it's hard work that has to be done well before the campaign starts. One of the things I learned through the process is, and you'll find that a lot of political libertarians are really
get a little closer to the mic, please.
A lot of political libertarians are savvy at this, is you get to read the RSAs, the revised statute annotated, that's the laws of New Hampshire, and become an expert at it. Such to a point that that basically you know what a lawsuit, where you can really push the limit, that a lot of the, quote, state reps, a lot of the public officials are ignorant of the law, which eventually brings you to bringing multiple lawsuits. So you learn law without the benefit of law school real quick if you're going to be in this for any long period of time. But then when you get to campaigning, then the other parties have institutionalized a way of holding you down, holding you back, and you have to break through that. And the media also. Some of it is our fault as libertarians because we don't know how they work, because we haven't engaged in the process like the Democrats and Republicans have for such a long time. But the thing of it is, the news media needs something with meat on it. You just can't, although they, like WMUR, want you to send press releases every day. Whether they respond to it or not, it doesn't matter. They want you to send them every day to show you have an active campaign. The old notion was that you had to have a statewide race to be considered serious. And to do that, you need to open offices several places. Well, in today's virtual world, that's not necessary anymore. You still got to get out there, but to have an office in every major town and whatever? No, but it is important if you're running statewide office to know key people in those towns, like Keene, like Concord, like Berlin, Claremont, Lebanon, Portsmouth, Nashua, Manchester. You need to know people there and really create buzz and excitement. I've been running for governor during 2000 season. I was actually on the ballot because we had petition, but they wouldn't allow me into the debates. And so to create a scene, I actually walked in, and a police chief of Berlin actually escorted me out, but a good friend of mine, Jim Cole, who's the state's AP photographer, photographed that, and it made headlines. That did more for my campaign than actually being there arguing, because it made Mary Brown look like a hypocrite at the time she was running for governor also, because we libertarians actually helped her get on the ballot by telling her all the things she needed to get on the ballot as an independent. We called for her inclusion in the debates, and when it came time for her to step up to the plate, she didn't. All right, but then again, I made more coverage by being escorted out in a photograph like that. So it's timing your opportunity to take advantage of the discrimination that is held against non-major parties. But over time, we have seen that it gets worse as it goes on. As you get more successful, they'll put more roadblocks in front of you. First, it was raising it from 3% to 4%, and lately they've raised it that we used to collect whenever we started. Now we only have a six-month window, and that's now in federal court on appeal. But, you know, petitioning is the big key factor.
And speaking of petitioning, that brings us to Chris. Chris moved to New Hampshire in, what was it, like April, May of 2014?
It was March.
March, okay. That was close. I knew it was, you know, the springtime of 2014, and you saw an opportunity to run for sheriff because the guy that's currently the sheriff here in Cheshire County is horrible. The guy that was running against him was even more horrible. And so you decided to run for sheriff. I tried advising you a little bit on some of the petitioning stuff, but you ran into some, shall we say, rather unique situations with some of the towns. So talk about that, and then we'll talk about your appeal to the Ballot Law Commission.
Fair enough. Yeah, so what do you do when you're a new mover? Hey, you want to get involved. So what position in a county doesn't have any residency requirement? Turns out sheriff. So I thought that would be a good place to get my feet wet. And I figured, you know, hey, 3 months in state, I've got my credentials now, right? I'm a local.
And it should be noted that, Chris, you're a member of Oath Keepers.
Yes.
So, you know, this isn't just some guy that's like, I think I want to be sheriff. It's a guy with military experience. He's a member of Oath Keepers. So, you know, he's got some, you know, street cred, if you will, for what people would look for in a sheriff.
Debatable, but we'll give you the benefit of the doubt and go along with that. It was interesting. So there is a ballot access process that involves gathering petitions, and that ended up being the real hitch. What I did want to touch on before we get into that was the fact that I ran as an independent. So, you know, I spent most of my life as a Republican, and I kind of shed that skin. I've never really seen myself as a Democrat. And at this point, I'm just very reluctant to fall in with any party, you know. I hope the Libertarian platform, when it becomes more viable in New Hampshire, might be something I can take a look at. But a lot of people with Libertarian views just choose not to choose any party. We're just not going to do anything. And that was the path I took in this.
Now, that's the problem with being rugged individualist.
Yeah, yeah.
Joining groups.
So for me to get on the ballot to run against the Republican and the Democrat, I would have to gather 150 signatures.
Valid
signatures from people that are registered to vote within Cheshire County. And that sounded pretty doable, pretty easy. Gathering signatures is not as easy as it sounds. You get a lot of people that they walk away when they see a clipboard. And a lot of people, particularly in Keene, were just like, well, but I like our current sheriff. I said, this isn't about that. That's about whether people should be allowed to run against him. But I like him. All right, okay. So in the end, after not a tremendous effort by myself, I will say, we ended up with about 168, 170 signatures. I needed 150. And as the next step in the process is, okay, I have to deliver all these signatures to every town so they can verify that every single person who signed is actually registered to vote there, and this is their correct address, and they are who they say they are. We went into that. As I start to get feedback from towns, you know, most towns are coming back saying, yep, all your people are good, no problem. But then I get a couple small towns where they, for some reason, they're saying that 3 out of 5 people in this town are not valid. And then I get one town that says, we don't recognize any of these submissions because we weren't here when you dropped them off and slid them under the door at the building.
There's an RSA, a revised statute annotated, that specifies a filing deadline, and also within that RSA, or another RSA, there's a stipulation that the town offices must be open during a certain window on the deadline, and some of the towns did not have anybody there. I helped deliver petitions for Chris, and in the town of Fitzwilliam, nobody was there, so they have a bulletin board, and there were some thumbtacks. I put the petitions up under a thumbtack. Those came back as valid to Chris. There was another town where Chris actually delivered these, and they said, we weren't here. We don't know that they got here before 5 o'clock because you put them on the back door, even though, or the front door, even though we go in the other door. So we didn't see them until 2 days later, so we don't know when you dropped them off. And then you had some interesting conversations with the Secretary of State's office over those.
Oh, yeah. But various towns, in some areas, it seemed like a very deliberate attempt to keep anybody from being on the ballot, and it was coming up with reasons. In my own town, I filled out a ballot, a petition, because I'm allowed to under law. That was rejected by our local election board. They said, well, we don't think you can do that. I said, well, I can. Did you think of calling the Secretary of State and checking? By then, it was too late. And in some towns like Keene was took the hardest line of all, and they were anything. If the signature did not look close enough to them, apparently Keene only hires handwriting experts to work in their town clerk's office. Then they were rejected, and it was, we lost 50% of the petitions that we submitted in Keene, so it was pretty bad. But again, you'll see things that are plainly partisan, and sometimes it's just ignorance.
So in total, you were 21 petitions short. And before we talk about the Ballot Law Commission, let's talk about the actual process of petitioning in New Hampshire. So petitioning in New Hampshire is unlike petitioning anywhere else in the country, because in New Hampshire, each person that signs has their own petition that they are signing. Nobody else can sign that form except for the election people in the town or the city saying this is either valid or invalid. So when you collect 150 signatures, you have 150 pieces of paper that you have to go out and get signatures from 150 people, everybody on a separate piece of paper. If somebody says, well, I don't know if I'm registered to vote. In most states, you can hand them a voter registration form and say, fill this out and then sign my petition. In New Hampshire, you cannot do that. In order to register to vote, you must present yourself physically to the town or city clerk and then register to vote in front of the town or city clerk. That's the only way to register to vote in New Hampshire. So it makes it more difficult in that aspect. And then also, depending on where you're petitioning, you might have people from, like the neighboring county or a town that's just outside of your district. It's more difficult, much more difficult in New Hampshire. And the professional petitioners will tell you the same thing. I know several of them, and they all say it's more difficult here. That's why they charge more per signature in New Hampshire. So now let's talk about the Ballot Law Commission, where, Chris, you have the opportunity under New Hampshire law to appeal a ballot decision of whether you're on or off the ballot to the Ballot Law Commission. You did this. You went to the Ballot Law Commission, and I went with you. I filmed most of the hearing. My batteries kept dying. But it was a rather interesting hearing, because they were asking you some questions of, okay, so if you add together all of the ones that were rejected from this town that rejected everything, how many would you have? So talk about that process of the Ballot Law Commission.
Well, my major problem, and I was happy to have Darryl there because he's a wealth of knowledge when it comes to New Hampshire ballot access law. My issue was these kind of documented and repeated attempts to disenfranchise voters. Not me, but the voters that wrote their names on my petitions, they wrote them saying, we would like to see you on the ballot. And those people were disenfranchised when these were tossed out for whatever spurious reason. So I kind of went in questioning the entire process, and in some cases said, you know, how can this be justified? How can you, as the Secretary of State's office, not take some action against these towns, against their town clerk? What happens to them? Well, you know, we'll send out another memo and remind people and things like that. That's the extent of the action that's taken. It was a very austere group. I don't know who all was in that room. I think a number of state senators and was a...
There is at least one person that's now a state rep that was there because he was challenging somebody's eligibility to be on the ballot. The Secretary of State and the Deputy Secretary of State were both there. The Secretary of State, the 900-year-old dinosaur... may he get dementia, or he probably already has it. He needs to leave office very soon. But this senile old man was asked by the Ballot Law Commission his thoughts on petitioning and whatnot. And it should be noted, in 2014, there were 16 people that filed statements of intent to petition onto the ballot in June of 2014, because everybody that intends to petition has to file in June. Petitions are due at the end of July. They get verified by the towns in August, then they go to the Secretary of State. So only about half of the people that said, I want to petition onto the ballot, actually wound up getting onto the ballot. So the Secretary of State was asked by the Ballot Law Commission his thoughts, and he said, well, I think it's too easy to get on the ballot because somebody that runs for sheriff as a Republican or a Democrat needs 10,000 votes to win an election. Well, here's something interesting. There were, in 2014, only two candidates for sheriff in the entire state in a primary that had a primary opponent, meaning that 18 of 20 people running for sheriff had no primary opposition, which means that they really needed one vote to get on the general election ballot. But the Secretary of State says it's too easy for anybody to get on the ballot as an independent or minor party candidate.
Well, you are forgetting one thing, what the Secretary said when they asked him, what do you feel about this? That his first words were, about what?
Oh, yeah, he was like, what? Several times, because he could not hear the question or wasn't paying attention, or his hearing aid wasn't turned on. I'm not sure. So let's talk about now some of the things that libertarians or independents can do to help further libertarian ideologies. John, if you had some advice for somebody that wanted to work outside of the two-party system to influence change, what would you suggest be done?
Just remember one thing, that it's people getting together. Whether they're Republican, Democrat, whatever, if you can find that issue you have in common, then I strongly suggest, when Don Gorman offers it, is to go to the State House and learn how to testify. Because the more people show up on certain bills, the more influence you have. Learn the facts of what you have to say. Don't repeat what the person in front of you has just said to the committee. If you have any new insights, put those in. If you're at the State House that day and there's some bills you like, go in and fill out the card saying, you know, you would like to see that bill passed or not passed. But you need to have influence by talking to people, whether they're your state reps or other party leaders, even party leaders in other parties. You need to talk, because it is people to people. And the influence we have, look at other states have already took care of their marijuana problem. The state's still holding back, not because of Republicans this time around or past few sessions, but the Democrats, because they're more worried about the chiefs of police union, whereas before, they were the champions of things like this, and they've given up their principles in order to get elected and live off the money and the unions that help them get elected. So you see, they're really running for their constituency, which is not the people of New Hampshire anymore. It's the people who make it available for them to get in power. And as libertarians, we need to do the same thing. We need to talk to people, because remember, as Don Gorman would say, if you're on the side of the people, you have a winning ticket.
Don, what advice would you give?
Well, I like John's idea quite a bit. Libertarians especially have to realize that standing out on the street corner with big signs yelling and screaming and blowing horns and throwing snowballs at police cars or whatever the hell that kind of stuff is going to get you nowhere fast. If you want to change, if you want to influence what is going on at the state level, then John's absolutely right. You have to show up and present your argument tastefully to the committee that is going to make a decision on this piece of legislation. For the last 5 years, I have been running a training program for freshman legislators. I have an open policy on that. Any one of you could show up and learn about the process, how it works. You don't have to be an elected representative to attend my sessions. However, I do have strict rules. If you show up for my session, even though it's practice and what have you, you're going to be dressed the way John and I are today. You're not going to come here with a t-shirt and shorts and sneakers, because I'll just ask you to leave. You are coming there as a representative of the people to produce your argument to the legislative body that is having influence over your particular piece of legislation. That is a tremendous, powerful thing that you are doing. So you have to look the part, you have to speak the part. One of my rules are, if you can't say it in 3 minutes, you can't say it. So don't say anything if you can't say it in 3 minutes, and that's about 2 minutes and 54 seconds. Thank you.
Chris, before I get your answer, I just want to let everybody know, if you do go testify, as John mentioned, if you have nothing new to say, don't say it. And legislative committees love the following sentence: I waive my testimony because I have nothing new to say. They love it. And they wish that more people would do that, because I've been at hearings where you've got seven people back to back to back that are saying the exact same thing. So yeah, if you go testify, have new information. All right, Chris.
I think we've all touched on this to some degree, but to be effective, to get out there, I think we really need to change. We need to change conversations, and that means conversations with actual people. And that will lead to these things becoming political issues, and that's what I think we're all very good at. Don touched a little bit on the value or perceived value of kind of the in-your-face activism versus taking a more civil approach. I personally see value in both sides. I think we do need rabble-rousers out there that get people's attention and bring attention to issues. But then we need people that are going to be able to articulate the reasons why these things need to change. So to me, I mean, everything I've done starts out with conversations, and those are conversations with Democrats and Republicans. Every once in a while around here, you run into a libertarian. But trying to find common ground and trying to find those issues that are important to them and important to you. And when we bridge those gaps, then suddenly we find allies here and allies there, not on all the issues, but some on all of them. Thanks a lot.
So if you have questions, there's a audience microphone. Just line up. I've got a couple more things that I want to hit on, and then we will go to audience questions. So if you have those, line up. And I'll take questions as I see people. So one of the things that I've been doing to sort of influence some of the policy is I've essentially become a shadow legislator on the election law committee. to where I read every bill that winds up going through that committee. I review the bills through the New Hampshire Liberty Alliance, and I would encourage everybody that lives in New Hampshire that wants more liberty to get involved with the NHLA. One of the things that I've been doing for the NHLA, as I said, is reviewing bills. Last year, I reviewed over 100 pieces of legislation. I read a lot more than that. So the review process is you read the bill, then there's a questionnaire on the NHLA website that you fill out of, does this bill advance liberty? Is it negative towards liberty, or is it neutral? And there actually are times where something is neutral to where it will make some minor change that isn't going to, you know, make more liberty or less. A couple of you guys mentioned about the cemetery board of trustees, and there was a bill last year that would have listed the cemetery trustee on the list of incompatible offices in towns to where you can't be like a selectman and on the cemetery trustee. That basically, it's neutral to liberty. And in some of these towns, and ultimately it got rejected because of this, in some of these towns you have so few people that you have to have somebody that is one thing and something else. Otherwise, all right, well, half the seats are vacant because we don't have enough people. So I reviewed all of the bills going through the election law committee, and I attended almost every hearing that they had. I think there were two bills that I missed and one executive session. Yes, Don.
It's wonderful everything you're saying about yourself, but the three of us sitting here and some people that would like to ask questions or makes us make statements. So I would appreciate it if we could take questions from the audience or something.
Yeah, if anybody has a question, please come to the microphone. One thing that I'm encouraging people to do is something that I'm doing. So when I'm explaining what I'm doing, it's not that I'm bragging, it's that I'm asking people to do something, and I'm not going to ask somebody to do something that I'm not willing to do myself. So review legislation, go testify as often as you can. If you're able to go to every hearing, go to every hearing. And one thing that I see that's sort of overlooked by a lot of liberty activists is the non-sexy legislation. Because a lot of people, you get standing room only for the guns and the weeds bills. And pretty much everything else, there might be a handful of people showing up. Any thoughts on any of that, John or Don or Chris?
Well, everybody has their one passionate issue. If I went to the State House for all my passionate issues, I would never be home. And that is a problem. You got to pick and choose how much time you dedicate it. But reading bills is a good thing, especially Darryl did do a few things on the ballot access to read that tipped us off, and we filed a lawsuit with the ACLU against the Secretary of State that is now in the appellate division of the First District because we had an adverse ruling in Concord from a federal judge. But one of the things as an activist is, or a candidate, is when you have standing, sometimes just saying the law is bad or having civil disobedience is one thing, but it's another thing is to properly execute it to the ultimate. And the ultimate is to have the state prove themselves one way or the other, whether we live in a free society or not. And when it comes to ballot access law, I can tell you we do not live in a free society, but yet the most expertise people on ballot law access really are the libertarians, because we have to live it, eat it, sleep with it. And so for the first time ever, I actually had to testify in federal court. It's a new experience. But we've had several constitutional cases. Some go our way, some don't. But one thing we want the state apparatus, if you will, know, that we're not going away, that we're going to fight hard, and we're going to cost them every bit of the way. either we cost them in their legal fees, or we're going to cost them in bad PR for the state, or whatever it takes. We're not going away.
Don, Chris, any thoughts? Any questions from the audience? We've got about 15 more minutes on the panel. I would hate to end early, but I will if there's nothing else to say.
So the Libertarian Party in New Hampshire is, honestly, it's pretty weak. You know, I think I went to one of the yearly conventions, and there was maybe 20 people there. And I expected a lot more when I moved to New Hampshire, and obviously we've seen a lot of the Free State Project participants getting involved in the Republicans and Democrats. Ballot access isn't, you know, the changes to those things aren't around the corner. I mean, there's not even really anything on the immediate horizon as far as that goes, because it seems like the Republicans and Democrats would like to keep things the status quo, and neither of them are really too interested in letting any third parties play. What can the Libertarians do to make themselves more present, more meaningful in this state? You never see or hear anything from them, and I'm involved in the party, so I'm not hearing or seeing much of anything either.
Okay, I'll take it from my aspect. I've been with the party for over 20 years. Actually, it's probably getting closer to 30. But after a while, you'll see in any organization too few people doing too much, and they get burnt out, and it comes in cycles. I mean, there was a few years I was quiet, and I've started back up again. And it's tough. It takes a lot of time. But I think what happens is, people think it's easier just to sign up as a Republican and Democrat. And the way it used to be, I think you get a lot of people that, oh, Republican, fine. You know, I'm a Republican, or think like that. They're right most of the time. But I think people have to be cautious now. There's a new dynamic. There are more registered independents, undeclares, than there are Republicans or Democrats. And that trend has been steadily increasing. On both sides, are Republican and Democrat are losing ground. I think a lot of it has to deal with crony capitalism. People are so sick of the party politics that you vote for somebody based on what they say in the campaign, on principle, and as soon as they get to Washington and Concord, they do just the opposite. And I think people are kind of sick of that. I think people with a good outreach as either an independent, libertarian, or anything but Democrat, Republican, has a viable campaign. Now, why the Libertarian Party? Well, if you had it an easy way, what would you rather prefer? Pay $2 or $5 to run for state rep, or actually have to collect, realistically, 200 signatures to get your 150 to be on the ballot, and to, quote, campaign, and to spend additional money trying to get elected? Or you could take the easy way, pay your money. There are some places where Republicans don't even have to run because it's so overwhelmingly Republican district that just putting your name on a ballot, you're practically guaranteed to be elected. And I think those easy days are probably going to be coming to an end shortly for the Republicans and Democrats in certain districts. So I think the Libertarian needs more people that get involved. I think there's too few people trying to run the top level. It's not that they want to run it, it's who's going to step up to the plate. And I think we need more new energy. I think that's the key thing. Because in our heart and soul, we all want liberty, and we're going to have to fight for it no matter how. And I like to see the Libertarian Party be more active, issuing press releases, whatever. But you know, you have to have people with the talent to write press releases. You have to have people willing to organize or be a community organizer. Maybe it'll get you president. I don't know.
One thing I'd add to that, I think what we really need to do is tackle the root problem, which is our ballot access laws themselves, and why it keeps not only libertarians off of the ballots, but it keeps, you know, a Green Party or anybody else from being able to run effectively. We're all very good at coming up with a method to get elected, or we hope to, using the system that we have. But where I think we really need to go is changing that system. It's horrible, and it's the in my mind the least right thing about New Hampshire.
Don, any thoughts?
Yeah, actually, I take a different slant entirely. What I do is I step in at the plate when the people are elected. And I'm speaking at the state house level because it's familiar ground for me. I mean, everybody up there, from the janitor to the governor, knows who I am. Where do I step in? First of all, I don't care whether you're a Republican or a Democrat. I do care very, very strongly if you are liberty-minded, if you are going to vote liberty votes. That I care about. So if I say to a person, where are you on Second Amendment issues? And they say, oh, I don't like guns, and they're killing all these children, and blah, blah, blah. You know, I've just wiped you off of my slate. I don't even want to talk to you. If somebody else says I'm pro-Second Amendment, then I want to work with that person. If we have, and I know approximately the number, we have a bunch of liberty-minded people that are in the state house right now. And I can honestly say that we have enough of a collection of them that they could probably stop any piece of legislation coming down the pipe. Think about that. They could probably stop any piece of legislation coming down the pipe. Now, how do you do that? I'm not saying the Democrats can, the Republicans can, the Republicans can if they have the Democratic help and yada, 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 yada. I'm saying we have enough liberty-minded people in the state house right now that could stop any piece of legislation coming down the pike. I don't care if they're a Democrat or a Republican. I care that they would vote libertarian or have liberty ideals or liberty principles. Once they're in established, then you can go and gather, say, 10 of them and say, look, we have a real problem here with ballot access. And believe me, we have, you know, tons of examples. We need to look at the ballot access laws. I need you guys to get in there. Now, it could be somebody that I'm talking to is actually on that committee, or maybe a person that was on that committee last term and now they're on transportation or something, but they know those laws inside out. And then you lay out your case. You say, here's what we need. For example, if we go out and petition for, say, 50,000 signatures statewide to become a political party on the ballot, then the law has got to be changed to say that that stays there forever. You don't take it away. You don't have to go out and get 50,000 signatures every term. So there's a drastic change that would move the election laws in the correct place. So that's the way I do it, and that's about it.
I was curious your thoughts on the presidential race. Do you see value in participating, and do you see like a best case scenario that would be ideal for liberty, and are you excited about Gary Johnson? Thanks.
Let me start by saying Gary Johnson has not declared that he's running in 2016. He keeps dancing around it, saying, I hope to run, I hope to be the nominee, but he has thus far not done anything as far as saying, I am running. He's not participated in any of the Libertarian state conventions as a candidate. There was a debate down in Massachusetts a couple of weeks ago at the Massachusetts Libertarian Party convention where myself, Steve Kerbel, Mark Allen Feldman, and Derek Michael Reed debated. The video of that is up on YouTube. And I do see value in participating in elections that I know I can't win because, as Chris mentioned earlier, it does allow you to sort of shift the debate or hopefully shift the debate. Let me turn it over to the panel and get your thoughts.
Well, I'll take a stab at that one. Sometimes there's not a good comedy on TV, and sometimes then I'll turn on national, maybe a debate or something like that. I used to be so into it, very much so. I was lifelong Republican, and I live for this stuff. The longer I'm up here, the more I find myself concerned with how much money the town's going to spend on gravel for the winter, and things that are more important to me locally than anything that happens in Washington. So it keeps fading for me. It's almost with every passing day. With that said, I do value those candidates that are out there that are driving the conversations in areas that are uncomfortable for the mainstream, such as a Gary Johnson, who I did support last presidential election.
And Don, you actually ran for the Libertarian nomination in 2000. So at one time, you saw a benefit in participating in national elections. Has that changed for you?
Oh yeah, a lot more gray on the beard. And anybody who thinks that running for a presidential candidacy is an easy task, just because you're a small party, you have to do all the things that the big kids do. You have to schedule airline tickets, you have to schedule transportation, you have to get your packages to whatever convention you're going to be speaking at. I went to 37 different states. I can honestly say it was one of the best educational values I ever got. Listening to the problems locally, the situations locally, so on and so on. But you need an organization behind you. It doesn't have to be 50 people, but you need somebody in charge of transportation. You need somebody in charge of appointments. You can't keep this stuff all in a little notebook, even a Apple notebook. You cannot do it. There is too much going on. It is a grueling thing. I can remember more than one time coming out of Chicago at 11:30 to land at Manchester at 1 o'clock. So it's not easy. You do get a chance to have your name out there and your face out there, and you do really get a chance to influence votes. I was on a lot of local TV, local talk-in radio programs where people would call in and ask questions and things like that. So there was a lot of exposure for the libertarian philosophy, the libertarian principles, that kind of thing. And I'll have to admit that I found the general population very interested and in some cases intrigued with the fact that there's this whole new concept of, what do you mean? You're going to have a playground furniture and half the people are going to donate their time and money instead of taking it all from the government when I have this free money grant? It's very responsive. And of course, as a presidential candidate, you were invited to everything. If it was New Hampshire and I was coming from another state, MUR would want to talk to me. The union leader would want to talk to me. We would send out press releases to Portsmouth and Nashua and places like this. So it does give you great exposure. However, it's a grind. So no, I think I'm beyond that myself right now. Thank you.
John?
I think running a presidential candidate does have value. It allows us to have a chance to go on syndicated nationwide radio shows to present our point of view, a different way of thinking. I think if we had ballot access with the First Nation primary going on, we would also have a primary going on, and that several of our presidential candidates would create a buzz and excitement considering what the other two parties have running right now. So there is value. Should we spend all our resources on it? I don't think so. I mean, before, the Libertarian Party would always get all 50 states. But some of these states, and New Hampshire being one, have constantly tightened and tightened the regulations that makes it, party-wide petitioning is not economical. So I think some of that's going to have to change for us to have a big influence here on that. Will we have a libertarian presidential candidate on the ballot in 2016? Probably, but when you're talking a party-wide petitioning, the cost to implement that is over $60,000. And I don't know how they're going to justify that for 4 electoral votes. I don't think it's necessary a good thing to do that in New Hampshire at this point, unless there is some relief. And I don't think the legislature is going to come up with that. But I do see value in libertarian going out there and spreading the word.
And then, since you did mention about petitioning in 2016, how difficult do you think it would be to collect the 3,000 petitions needed to get just the presidential candidate on the ballot in June and July? Because the nominating convention for the Libertarian Party is Memorial Day weekend. So that gives us June and July to collect 3,000 petitions. How feasible and how doable do you think that is?
I believe for 3,000 it's doable, providing you have enough ground forces, which means paid petitioners. You're not going to do it with volunteers. It's just, unless you have volunteers, like a dozen volunteers that are willing to spend every day, because during that time period, there's a lot of out-of-state people in state, and it makes it more difficult, because you have to have a voter sign that, not just a resident or a visitor.
John? I'd like to... If I may, I'd like to play a little game here, because it's hard to read what's going on in everybody's mind. So I am going to run out a scenario. This is the kind of stuff I do at the State House with my legislators. I play these kind of games. So hypothetically, I'm making this all up. There is a slot for state representative somewhere in the state of New Hampshire. Let's say it's in Keene. And let's say that we have 3 libertarians that want to run for that slot. How many people in the room think that all 3 people should run for that slot? There's 1 slot, 1 seat open, 3 libertarians want the seat. How many people, raise your hands, how many people should run for that slot, the three people? How many think 3 is the correct answer? Nobody. Let me ask you this. Supposing we had the same 3 people and they got together in the room and said, I got a better idea. One of us can get elected. You are going to run as a Democrat. You are going to run as a Republican. And I am going to run as a Libertarian. How many people in the room, raise your hands, think that's a good idea? Yeah, absolutely. What are you doing? You're taking liberty-minded people, I don't care what you call them, liberty-minded people, and putting them in a position of power. That's the name of the game. Thank you.
So we've got time for either one final question or closing thoughts. And seeing no one at, okay, so we do have somebody coming up to the microphone. This is JP. He will be hosting the Cop Block panel that is after this one. JP, what's your question?
The question is, I'm a baby in the liberty movement. I've only been involved in Cop Block for just a few years, and that is what introduced me to the libertarian side of political side. But I never hear the politicians that veer for the libertarian side speak about anything about police accountability and what their view is on recording police or vice versa. I don't know if you know, but I got a Cop Block video with Gladys Johnson telling me I had no right to videotape her or the police. So I just wanted to know what your view was.
Sure. You have the right to videotape any public official in their public job. I mean, that's bottom line. The court has, the First Appellate Court has made that law further backed up in New Hampshire.
Part 1, Article 8.
Yes.
Public officials are to be accountable at all times.
But I know Gladys Johnson actually proposed a bill for the state police to wear lapel cameras, but the part of the bill was to prohibit the public from actually seeing that footage.
There should be some protections for the privacy of the person that the cops are, but it should be the pr- privacy of the person involved, not the cop. Cop's job, he's representing the people. His actions must be accountable. But say it was a bad scene and the people who where the cop visited, it's their privacy, they can suppress that unless it's out in the street. But for the cop to say, well, you can't see that, well, I think that's incorrect. Because evidence is evidence, all right? And the first chance the defendant has is suppression of evidence. You just can't release it like that. But anything is fair game. If the person that is involved in that situation says, I want it released, it should be released, period.
Right. Yeah, absolutely, unequivocally, no questions asked. You, anybody in this room, all of us, have the right to photograph, video, a public official doing public business. You can't take a video in his bathroom window or something like that, but if it is a public official doing public business, you absolutely have the right. Now, let me give you an example. You're in a committee hearing room up at the State House. The chairman of that committee is in charge of that room. He basically owns it for the duration of the term. You come in with your camera and set it all up and start videoing the process, the people that are witnesses that are testifying, the whole thing. You're putting it all on tape. And the chairman says, I'm sorry, I don't allow videotaping in my committee room. What do you think? Is that legal, illegal? Can he say that or not say that?
He's acting in his official capacity, so.
That's right. It's not his capacity. If he told me to take my camera out of there, I'd be pounding on the speaker's door 30 seconds later, asking for a new chairman because this guy doesn't understand the Constitution.
Also, if you note that any time the governor is in session or the executive session, that gallery has to have at least 5 seats available to the public. When I mean public, when you have inauguration of governor, you'll see the balcony filled with commissioners or whatever. They have to have seats available for any member of public, not just press, any member of public walking off the street. You gotta get there early, but they have to leave seats open because it is our right.
I think I'd add to that this does not have to be just a statewide issue. It doesn't have to be just legislation that happens in the State House. We've had this conversation in my town. Do we need to provide? And it usually comes from the law enforcement side saying we need to get better evidence, but that's okay. Would they consider wearing lapel cameras? Would they consider cruiser cams? That's a conversation you can have with your local police department, with your local selectman to broach that subject. And you know, for whatever reason, you're still changing the conversation to what's important, and that's police accountability.
Do I have room for one more?
You can ask a follow-up, yeah.
Okay. The second question is, what do you think about the police academy here in New Hampshire teaching and training all the police in a combat-oriented way? If you see the training videos and look online and watch Special Forces videos, they're almost identical.
I have a problem with it, and again, this goes back to the history of back into the early 60s. They used to be peace officers. Some of the people are fortunate in small towns. We still have peace officers, but the emphasis is now in law enforcement. And unfortunately, I think they're lacking in the understanding of people's rights in the Constitution, and never mind that, just plain old simple human rights. And I think they have to realize that they're not a military force, because if they continue the course they're getting, people will respond in kind. Okay, right now the preferred method of peaceful people is the camera. But if they get even more violent, that may not be the case.
Yeah, I agree 100%. I think the training of your police departments is getting way, way, way out of hand in regards to military type of helmets and bulletproof vests and knee pads and night scopes and, you know, carrying 15 pouches of 30 rounds of ammunition. What are you going?
I call them ninja turtles.
Battle of war or something, you know? There's no need of this. If a situation is so far out of control that normal police activities cannot handle it, and we don't want rioters burning down buildings and smashing the place up, there should be units that could be called in for that particular instance, for that incident, for that moment. I would say bring them in from the National Guard. That is a military organization. Get the police out of there. If it's that bad that you need military force to stop the destruction and whatever's going on, then call in your National Guard, and there should be a trained unit in there that understands police, not combat, that there's a difference here. These police departments that have machine guns and armored cars and God knows what all, I mean, what is this all about? I don't get it, but anyway.
I'll answer and say that it's completely appropriate. We have war in this country. Does anyone doubt that? Is there not a war on drugs? Have we not been fighting this for 40 some years? When you have a war, you need to train as a military. You don't train as law enforcement, as peace officers. So when we get to root cause, it's the fact that we've declared war, our government has declared war, on its very citizens. So if we want to address the concerns with the militarization of police, and this is something I'm very passionate about, we need to do away with the root causes of that, and that's declaring whether it's a war on poverty or war on drugs, whatever it is. We've got to quit declaring war on ourselves.
And Chris, I'm glad you brought up the war on drugs thing, because there's something that you had mentioned to me that might be happening in Alstead, and we'll close on this. To where there's a proposal or might be a proposal to basically make Alstead a demilitarized zone in the war on drugs?
Well, that may be premature, but there have been conversations with a few of us who are considering taking the approach of town ordinances against certain
what are perceived as certain offenses?
Certain offenses that the state sees. So, for example, today it's more of a fine, and you face more charges for possession of marijuana paraphernalia than you do for the possession of marijuana in the state of New Hampshire, which is insane. Alstead passed a $100 fine should we catch you with paraphernalia. So we're trying to keep people out of the court system and getting wrapped up in all that. If our officers feel they have to issue something, they can issue it at the local level and it goes no further.
John, you seem confused.
Yeah, first of all, we're not a home rule state, but I appreciate putting a warrant article to at least get the sentiment of the people. Second, the war begins in your town with the police chief. So he's the one that needs to be have a little talk to. Just remind him of where, how many police chiefs they went through, because they couldn't listen to liberty. I think the crazy thing about ordinances is people weigh so much on a $100 fine. Really? You're going to fine me $100? I will take you and your silly little town to court. I'll bring it to the Supreme Court, and I'll cost you $100,000 on a drop. Are you kidding me? Who passes stupid ordinances like that with stupid fines like that that violate due process every which way? The ACLU would eat you for lunch.
Well, it's interesting because this is something that occurs in New Hampshire towns. What this does, and we can look at that, we can look at taking a law for open container or things like that, and say, let's. We are always going to have police. That's unfortunate, but it's for the near term. We'll have to accept that. Let's give them some different options, and the first option should always be, why am I charging this person at all? And that's what we look for in our police. You are, in a perfect world, we're going to get all law enforcement that looks at everything from a liberty point of view. But it's no time soon.
Let's try to educate them to say, who is this person harming? If it's no one, don't bother them.
All right, so final question, and make it quick, because there's only 7 minutes until the next panel.
I think I can do it in 7 minutes. New Hampshire is not, as you pointed out, a home rule state, but yet a given employer always has the opportunity to set policy for his employees. So what if you just prioritize on the police priority sheet, scraping gum off the sidewalk as higher than writing a marijuana ticket, so that if somebody writes a marijuana ticket and you can find any gum on the sidewalk, he's fired.
That's a good one. It gets a little quirky when you get into the RSAs that surround police chiefs. They do have a level of independence. So the selectmen, like myself, can direct them, but we cannot control them. We can choose to fire them and hire someone else and things like that. But there is a level that a level of independence that they are granted under RSA.
In my town, they are elected, so they don't go harassing people with silly fines. Now, the neighboring town is a different story, but in my town, you know, you really have to go out of your way to get a fine.
Yeah.
So I think the overarching message of this panel is get involved and get involved locally, because you can influence change locally a lot more than you can at the state level or, God forbid, the national level, which, you know, I'm sure a lot of us in this room want the U.S. federal government to go away completely. And if you're interested in secession, stick around for the secession panel hosted by Rob Mathias of the Rebel Love Show. That happens at, I believe, 3:30 this afternoon. Give a round of applause for the panelists, Chris Rietmann, Don Gorman, John Babiarz. The Cop Block panel begins in just a couple of minutes.
Keenevention is brought to you by Roberts & Roberts at rrbi.co when you're serious about precious metals. We don't feed the banks. Bitcoin payment preferred. Online at rrbi.co.
We'd like to invite you to visit freekeen.com. Freekeen.com features audio, video, and blogs chronicling the transition to a voluntary society. Freekeen.com also has comments and discussion forums so you can be heard. Freekeen.com.
I should be in Keene, New Hampshire with the Free Staters.